How are we going, guys? World Baseball Traveler here. Over the last 5 years, I've been traveling the world, playing baseball, and meeting some of the most incredible people with the most amazing stories. And I wanted to share them with you. So with the help of Drake Yoshioka, here is World Baseball Travelers, Episode 1, Part 1, featuring Nick Kern.
I think there's no better way than just to dive right into it. Let the people know who come across this or viewing this. Where you're from and the beginning of your baseball journey.
Yeah, dude. I'm from Brea, California. It's in Orange County. And I went to Braeland High School, which is right here, the local public school here. And then from there, UCLA for 5 years, actually, with some drama there. And then actually took a year off, more or less, right? Because I could have, right when UCLA ended, could have gone right into new ball season, took a year off, and then played, went to an open tryout for the Pacific Association, landed on the Napa Silverados for that year, played then the following year for the Sonoma Stompers, and then went into Australia, played Australia for their summer, our winter, which is perfect, for the MacArthur Orioles, and pretty much have had a blast the whole deal. So now we're here. So that's just kind of the general.
My first question is, how did that whole recruiting process start with you looking at going to UCLA? Because I know that people that are coming across this video either have played D1, never played D1, or maybe some high school kids who are looking at what's the process towards getting this. What was it like for you?
And this is really what did it. And I think if you're a high school kid listening to this, then this is the important part, is that in the fourth inning, I give up a 2-run home run. I think it was like close. We were down by 1 or something at that point. It was like 1-0 or something. 2-run bomb in the fourth, off of a guy who ended up playing Division I. Okay. And the next play, I mean, I like hits the bomb. Okay, I keep my cool. It wasn't like I was blowing anyone up or pissed my coach for calling that pitch. It's like, dude, that dude's just good. Okay. I mean, I was a real competitor out there. So, like, you know, it wasn't like, oh, I'm fine. No, I was like, just give me the ball, next guy. Mm-hmm. And the next hitter on like the second pitch hits a ground ball to the third baseman. And my third baseman fields it, sails it.
Oh.
And so you could kind of see there where, like, dude, like the wheels could be, you know, kind of falling off here.
Yeah.
Like, look good. And just, I mean, I played so much baseball, had a bunch of really good coaches and stuff. And the type of competitor that I was, it was like, I got the ball back, and I think the guy's on second base now. I get the ball back, and I turn to my third base, and I'm like, hey, I got you right here. And, like, got back on the mound, and I think I K'd the next guy, and then, like, a pop-up or whatever. But just that kind of – because I had that moment of being able to, rather than, like, you know, oh, my God, like, you guys can't pick me up. I got to do this myself.
That's what it was. You competed to get out of that jam.
It was competed, but it was also, like, you know, for the team, and it was like, hey – you know, I've been there. I made an error. I'm like, hey, I got you right here. Mm-hmm. So rather than me just like, hey, that's a free run, right? Like, that guy scores not on my ERA. Like, I could just go like, you know, whatever. We're losing this game anyway type of attitude. No, it was like, hey, bro, I got you. Because now I can pitch out of this. And that guy knows, like, hey, when, you know, shit kind of hits the fan a little bit, I'm a guy that you can kind of turn to. And so that's just kind of like character stuff that I think a lot of kids don't realize, like, that's really what it's all about. And also, you can't be really good if you don't have that. Like, I mean, maybe super rare, insanely talented. If you're trying to be the best player you can, moments like that is how you end up over the long haul performing really well and consistent. Say what I did love. I loved winning. And so I was like, I don't give a shit. Like, this is my senior year in high school.
Hey, I would have loved to see you pitch, though.
I don't fucking care, bro. I'm trying to win.
Stepping onto the coaching side of things, when you get to a point where you see a lot of good ball players, right? We get to a certain level, and guys pretty much are around the same athleticism wise. Now, what differentiates those guys is that mental side of things. You know what I mean? And I guarantee you, when Savage was sitting behind home plate, you showed the characteristics of what UCLA baseball is all about, right?
Exactly. He was so impressed by that moment that he said that's the best unsigned senior he had seen.
Love it.
Wow.
So, that's awesome.
Then UCLA calls. I go check out the school, blown away. It had everything I was looking for. And just ended up going as a recruited walk-on. That's kind of the spot you're in as a senior. But and looking back, if you really know the game better and or the game as far as the recruiting game and stuff, maybe could have gotten like a real small scholarship, made something happen. But instead, for me, it was like, I don't know. I was like, I just don't want to blow this. Like, this has everything I'm looking for. Like, yeah. Let's just do it. So. Yeah. A lot of these other schools wanted me as a position player. Some wanted me as a two-way. And UCLA was probably the only one that wanted me as a pitcher. And okay. My whole thing was, I just want to go to a good school and for a good team and play, hopefully, D1, because that's an ego thing, right?
Yeah.
It really doesn't matter. It's an ego thing. And, you know, I'm 17 or whatever at the time. And I literally was like, yeah, they want me to be a pitcher, but fuck it. Like, I'll just figure it out.
I'll just crack the lineup. No big deal.
Yeah, exactly. That's pretty much what I thought. So, I mean, there's more ego stuff. We'll there's an opportunity, and they'll give you
tell
all
you
that.
More. Here, man.
So they'll tell you all the – anytime you're hearing, like, you're getting an opportunity, that's pretty much just they're giving you what you want to hear. Only when they say, like, hey, we see you as XYZ, mm-hmm. that's what they're recruiting you for. Mm-hmm.
We see you as, because this is what I think you could fit in on our roster.
Yes. Oh, yes. There's so much in this. This is what.
No, it's all good.
You're good. You're good.
This is your journey, dude.
Fill us in.
This is how it goes. You sit down at the beginning of your college, like, they sit you down before the season and they say, like, hey, we see you doing this, we see you doing that. And this is kind of be your role a little bit for the team. And UCLA, this was the year 2013, which we ended up winning the national championship for, mm-hmm. on the backs of our pitchers, and I'm competing just as a pitcher. And so, I mean, I was a good pitcher, and I was, like, I ended up slotting in with, like, a good breaking ball, a knuckle curveball, a good fastball, pretty good command. I ended up slotting in as our plus or minus guy, which basically meant if we were up by 10 or down by 10.
Not the
not
the best place to slot in as, but
through the whole season, there was a couple times I got hot to throw and never made it in the game. So, like, the guy worked out of it and in plus or minus situations, right? Mm-hmm, so mm-hmm. I was on the active roster, traveled to, like, everywhere except for maybe one or two times I was a little beat up, kind of like a mini injury, so I wasn't throwing as hard, so I left off the roster, right? Comes down to the super regional, I don't make the 27-man roster. Another dude kind of gets healthy because I was right at that fringe. He gets the spot. I still haven't pitched. So, like, a lot of times, like, you'll go through half the season and they'll go, like, hey, you haven't pitched, so we're just going to redshirt you. But for me, I told him, like, don't freaking worry about it. So we're all the way into – we're going now. We have to choose a 27-man roster for the World Series, the College World mm-hmm. Series.
Wow, okay.
And me and this other guy, who was my roommate at the time, who – he's actually a good guy, but during that period, that dude was a piece of shit. And so we totally battled it out. He had all this stuff packed because, like, in your dorm, like, you got to be all packed up to go because the World Series is, like, when you have to leave and, like, you know, have all your stuff out of the dorms. Sure enough, just because I was healthy, throwing harder, they're like, Kern, you're on the roster. You're going to the College World Series. Having pitched this many
innings. Hey, dude, that's an experience, though.
Bro, that is so dope.
And then we go to the College World Series. I don't end up, because we shoved up everyone's ass.
Yeah, man, you guys were dominant.
That was so good back then.
Don't step between the lines and get to go on the 27-man roster, win a national championship, and was there and part of the team and, like, part of the dugout and stuff.
That is so legit.
So, yeah, man, that's kind of right how there. That went down. We'll see. It's over here, yeah.
Yeah.
That's that bad boy.
Beauty.
Man.
So.
Man.
Yeah.
That's your freshman year, right? And that in itself is a story.
Right? Yeah, it is.
Now, crazy. Run us through the next 3 years of Nick Kern, UCLA champion.
Andrew's injured, and this is the first night that Coach Savage says, "Hey, Nick, you're gonna be our closer for this series." And we're in Utah, so we're away, right at Utah. I hear, like, from the dugout. This is again the top of the ninth. I'm seeing kind of Savage make some motion or whatever towards the bullpen. And in my head, I'm like, yo, what does this guy want? Like, I'm like, look, am I hot? Yes, I'm hot. Like, I'm ready to go.
Yeah.
But this inning's still going. And then all of a sudden, you know, now the echo's kind of getting there. And they're like, no, no, come on down. And all of a sudden, you know, our kind of bullpen coach is like, no, head on in to the dugout. And like, you're going to hit. And I'm, you know, I'm getting so locked in for my pitching mentality. It's just like, yep, 100%. And I just jog on in. Next thing I know, I mean, it happens super fast. Guys are handing me my helmet, my batting gloves, everything. Our hitting coach is walking out with kind of a report, kind of telling us I'm facing their like left-handed closer. We've got a guy on third with two outs in the top of the ninth.
Oh, let's go. Let's go.
Okay. Like, Kern, you're in first AB.
We live for this.
They're left-handed closer, right? Because I'm a right-handed hitter. And dude, thank God I was in the mental space I was in. Because it was, I'm telling you, there was no fear. No, I was so certain that like, yeah, give it to, like, I've been telling you, give it to me. Let's go. Step in the box, right? I take the first pitch. I remember that, 0-1. And
Mike Kern, you took the first pitch, man. I don't think I've ever seen you take the first pitch.
This was always happening.
So, guy on third, two outs, top of the ninth, tie game, first AB. I take the first pitch, 0-1. I want to say the next pitch, I swing at a high fastball, foul it back, 0-2. And again, the state I was in, so in the moment. Wasn't thinking anything, wasn't afraid that, oh, two, you're going to K, your first AB or whatever, wasn't there. Just dead focused and way too confident for having no experience. Next pitch, and this is, I mean, the other team has to know that, hey, this guy's a, you know, he's their pitcher. He's only such pitching, doesn't have any ABs.
They're probably thinking this guy's a PO. Let's go right after
him. Yep. Right? 0-2, guy on third, so they probably don't want to throw a pass ball, breaking ball.
For sure, right? Yep.
They're like, this dude sucks. He's never played, and he's going to face our left-handed closer. So they go 0-2, heater. I don't know. I think it was supposed to be high and inside. Middle of the plate.
Oof.
I take this swing, see it taking off into the distance, put my head down, start hauling. Couldn't believe it, dude. Rounding first, this thing. I don't even see it go over the fence.
You can't put it on the board.
Let's go!
Umpire's right here.
Okay.
Love it. Love it. Now that right there, man. Now that gives me chills, dude. That's what we live for, man.
Yeah,
that's it.
Wow.
So, yeah.
So then tell me you go bottom ninth and just shut the door too.
And shut the door. Oh, one guy got off.
Oh, have a day. Have a day.
We win 3-1. We win.
This with the next phase, the junior senior year phase.
The next phase. Goes into now I prove that I prove him wrong, right?
Mm-hmm.
Now I kind of don't know what to do with myself. Like, that was such the driving force that I kind of fell into a little bit of a funk, because the motivation, like, and also, like, as crazy as that moment was, and I got more ABs throughout the year and stuff, I did feel a little lost after that. Went and pitched in a summer league. Pitched insanely well, hit like 300, so did both well. But then started to have some elbow problems. And with that came, you know, there's a whole game with the doctors, potential Tommy John, do not do Tommy John, rest. And that whole junior year was spent, you know, shutting down the hitting so we can just do the pitching, and just because the elbow can only take so much, finding out that wasn't even possible. So now, after not hitting for a period of time, shut down the pitching, just try and see if I can help the team offensively.
Mm-hmm.
But that you're not in a position to even do anything after you've taken, you know, a couple of months off of hitting, trying to go midseason.
It's tough, man. Yeah.
So that year was pretty much a wash. And the tough part there also was going into that year, I was set up to, I basically through my sophomore year earned myself a scholarship, and going into that junior year, which is awesome that even John Savage was going to do, you said he was going to do, because a lot of guys might say that we'll do that, but they have you. So there's not only incentive there is just by being kind of good people. Stuff kind of started to go down, and then my elbow was toast. And then they're like, you know, they're not going to give you a scholarship when your elbow's toast, type of thing.
Yeah,
so the scholar, although I earned it, it fell through from the injury. So then here's like, I thought, a gift from God. For the elbow deal, I go to the doctors and I'm like, hey, so look like they take a look at it. I have to actually go to a different facility because the guys at UCLA, I feel like they're playing some games. UCLA is usually phenomenal, but I don't know, through the athletic department, I didn't feel right about it. Mm-hmm. Saw a different guy, and he's like, "Oh yeah, you clearly like." He said, "This is pretty much the ultimatum you have." He's like, "You hit right?" I'm like, "Yeah." And he goes, "If you want to be a pitcher, like, you have to get Tommy John, because if you pitch right now with how your Tommy John looks, you've got like you're gonna blow it within 6 months." And these guys are pretty dang good with this stuff. Like, yeah. He's like the best of the best over Curling Joke. And says, but if you're not going to be a pitcher, this elbow will hold if we do a minor scope and clean up some of the other issues you have in there, and we do a PRP shot into the ligament and give that thing a little bit of extra juice. I think that you can play as a position player because it's just less intensive on that elbow. Yeah. And for me, that was like – perfect. I finally got the answer I need. I got it from a doctor.
I can only hit and play a position now. You put me back on the mound.
Like, I was like, it was like, you know, all my prayers have been answered type thing. So that's obviously what I went with. It was like, I was looking kind of, when the doctor said, I'm looking over my mom, I was just like, I can't believe I'm kind of hearing this type of thing. Like, not to get too spiritual on it, but it was like, It was like everything my soul wanted, and like the universe kind of came together.
Yeah.
Which was just so huge after all the years, and especially after the misery of that year of not really doing anything and helping the team and stuff falling through. So I go and tell Coach Savage that, and he's there obviously like, and plus I had thrown pretty dang well and been, and like that summer thrown so insanely well. It was clear that I was going to be a pretty high draft pick as a pitcher. I think the ballpark idea that Savage had thrown out was probably, had I done well that next year and or just continued as a pitcher, I potentially could have been like a fifth round type guy, draft pick as a pitcher. So for them looking at it, they're like, I can't believe you're just throwing away your career and this money.
Yeah.
Especially them as pitcher, like they're like, this is what they would dream for. Mm-hmm. And for me, I was like, I can't even, like, I would quit rather than be a full-time pitcher because that's just not what I love.
Yeah.
So it was obvious to me. I was like, so there was a disconnect there, right? And it was tough for me. I really tried to kind of express that with him, but I think there was still a disconnect. Just come from where he's coming from, right? So anyway, so it ends up, I get the minor scope, go to be a position player, tell him that's what I'm going to do. And he's kind of like, okay, but you're going to have to like really work. Like we had a rough year. We're trying to kind of turn over the roster or yeah. So they're like, well, we'll see if you kind of make the team type of thing. Like there's not even a roster spot guaranteed for you as a just a position player. Cause we don't know if you can field the ground ball or play off of whatever. And I was trying to come in as an infielder. So there was a lot of skepticism there. So I try and come back and, Right after the surgery, and as I'm training to kind of come back into it and trying to take ground balls and summer class, all sorts of stuff, that's when I had an autoimmune disease called ulcerative colitis. Yeah. So that's so for people who are probably like, what the hell is ulcerative colitis? Yeah. Or it's sister disease, Crohn's. More or less how I describe it is your body, your immune system looks at your large intestine and like, or your colon, those are the same. So 5 feet, 5 pounds in intestines in you, that's like the thicker one. And like the tissue, and they end up kind of identifying that as like kind of foreign or not supposed to be there. And so you have an immune response to it. It starts breaking down that tissue and you cause a ton of inflammation in there. And so you end up just in a ton of pain and honestly just shitting a ton of blood. And then you, for me, like I'm usually a guy that's like 195 pretty quickly. Tons of pain, started eating less, right? Just because if I eat, there's more pain.
Yeah.
And your body just lives off the muscle. So just ate the muscle and I shrunk to like 150 in no time. So just you know, 45 pounds of muscle, just boom. Anyway, so without diving, that story's kind of out there. And so I've ended up missing a full year for that and having 5 surgeries, like 60 plus days and nights in the hospital. Got pretty dicey for a little bit there. It's usually not that bad. Most people have ulcerative colitis is not that bad. And I landed just a really gnarly case of it. And it's, so anyway, so I ended up, So I kind of missed that whole senior year. But you know, had the red shirt I'd already done and stuff. So, but the thing that was kind of pushed me through that whole time was like, you got to imagine that whole dream I had of being a position player. Yeah. That was the dream.
You're right there.
Right. And I'm right there.
So cool.
There's just one final test you have to pass. And that is like, do you really want this? How about this? How about your, all of your muscles gone? You're on the fringe of death. This is going to be a hell of a story when I get back to baseball and when I become an infielder and a starting third baseman or shortstop for UCLA.
Yeah.
I'm getting the chills right now talking about it.
Love because it.
That is, that's for real how I got through kind of what I got through with a good attitude and always just ready to go and get back. Put up back on campus for a weigh-in, and I think I weighed 196 with 5 pounds of intestine missing. So heavier and stronger than I'd ever been because I was ready to come in. Yeah, honestly, the moment where I kind of gave up hope, finally, I was just like, dude, I guess I'm just never going to play. And this story is just not going to be what I thought it was going to be. I'm just sitting in the dugout. I've got my hat rather than like really on. It's just like high hat and sitting there. I'm just
chilling.
Next thing you know, this guy, our shortstop, gets hit in the hand, breaks his hamate.
Oh.
And it's just like, Kern, you're in. I had been like out partying that night, like hard. And I'm just like, all right, I go in. I don't get out that game. Like, I hit like a double, I think a double, maybe my first at bat, like another single up the middle, hit one hard straight out of guy through his legs, walked. Like when I go out to defense, first batter, chopper, chopper to the backhand at shortstop. I work over, do this super clean backhand in rhythm, hose it because I'm all fresh, you know, throw it 90, that pitcher arm across the diamond.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Like, right, let's go, boys. And
Kern's here.
Yeah.
Kern's here.
Love the legend. Let's go.
So,
I think they do like an article on you because you came back from that and then you played your senior year.
Yeah. So all of that shit, it, crazy as it is, you want to talk about visualizing and making something happen. Like it all happened. Like in a sense, maybe not as perfect as I had dreamed it up. But yeah, like so I ended up winning, two kind of cool awards. I got them actually right here. So there's this one, which is the CPSDA, which is basically a dietitian's association. And it's Muscle Milk Athlete of the Year award.
Wow,
so it's
okay.
And this isn't just collegiate. This is the people in the running for this, collegiate, professional, and military. Oh.
Wow.
And every year they go one male or one guy, one girl gets the award.
Any names that were in the running that year?
Oh, I don't even know. I didn't. They kind of just gave my story and like, you know, typed it up, whatever. And the dietitian at UCLA who had worked with loosely to put on the weight, she kind of submitted it. And I remember when she said, like, you know, she has to choose someone to submit it every year, but it was like, it's such a long shot type of thing. And I remember when I kind of learned, well, like, I'm the Muscle Milk Athlete of the Year. Like, what? It was pretty surreal for sure. And that, because I just didn't, there was no shot in hell. As crazy as it all was, I was like, I don't know. So that one was crazy. And then this is like, I think they could have given me a bigger trophy. This thing's massive. look for comparison. This is the one, this is that they gave me. And this is the personal one you get for winning a national championship.
Love
been
it.
So over the top, but
oh, bro!
At the same time, it's dope. Like, I mean,
oh, for sure, yeah,
100%, man. I don't have one like that. Shit,
I don't. Neither of us do. We don't got no muscle desk award either.
What does your desk look like? Yeah, I got the ring.
Looking kind of dusty over here.
Love it, man. So you reach what you had been trying to get to come for a long time, right?
Yeah.
So. Where did you go? What was the process after college?
Got another round of the ulcerative colitis stuff. Got real sick again. Lost the weight. And then also got a form of arthritis with it.